The pharma sector actually has been full of divergent trends in the recent past. While MNC pharma has done well, the domestic pharma companies have struggled with regulatory issues and other headwinds. What's in store for the sector going ahead? Let's pose this question to Anmol Ganju of JM Financial, who's joining us from the JM Financial Conference. Hi, Anmol. Good afternoon, and thanks a lot for joining us today. This is a sector which has been underperforming not just this year, last year. The Nifty Pharma Index has been giving negative returns now for the last 4 years. The pricing pressure still exists. We have seen that being reflected into the financials. And of course, the US FDA issues, a lot of companies receiving Form 83. How should now one approach this sector, considering the valuations now that a couple of these stocks are quoting? Do you see any sort of investment theme now that can emerge at current levels?
So yeah, hi, and thanks for having me for this interaction. So I think you bundled a lot of questions in your opening remarks, but basically I think the point to note is that domestically the market has begun to show signs of revival if the last couple of quarters are anything to go by. We have seen some of the large companies catering to the domestic market, which is primarily MNC Pharma, the basket that you refer to, and also select Indian pharma companies who cater predominantly to the Indian domestic pharma market, beginning to show signs of revival and record growth. So for example, we saw Cipla's number yesterday. The domestic growth did extremely well. Even for Lupin, the domestic part of the business did well. And MNCs, obviously, since they are 100% on a branded formulation side, India facing, have started to exhibit signs of some revival after 2 years of underperformance as far as operating metrics are concerned. Where we are seeing a challenge is large US bases. So companies in excess of say $600-700 million kind of a US top line to manage are still continuing to face intense pricing pressure, and their new launches are not sufficient enough to offset the decline in their base portfolios. So that is how the industry landscape is stacked up. India showing some signs of revival. US product specific, portfolio specific, and size specific, yes. So if you're kind of sub $200-250 million and have an interesting portfolio, there's still growth for you in the US. But the moment you kind of are in the bracket of north of $600 million, then there is a challenge. So your stock selection has to factor that. You know, while there are these three buckets, you have to be on the right side of some of these encouraging trends, because as you rightly said, for 4 years the sector has given negative returns and has underperformed. So I think a lot of meaningful reset of the base has already happened, and if one was to be right with their stock selections, things might just start looking up in the next couple of years.
Right. Anmol, just one more question on Sun Pharma, which comes out with its numbers today. Its subsidiary Taro has already reported muted set of numbers. I think as a house, you guys have a bullish view on this one. And this one has been tackling its own issues. There was a time when this used to be the darling of the street. We have seen higher levels here. What, according to you, can revive the growth now for Sun Pharma going ahead? And what's the expectations from the September quarter numbers?
So I won't be able to go into the September quarter per se, because they report today and I think we are too close to the event. But broadly, Sun as an investment theme, if you look at it, I mean, there are three distinct parts to it. One is that they continue to be the clear market leader in India with a market share in excess of 8%. That is a very, very attractive market sub-segment to have leadership in. This is a segment which continues to throw up cash. And as we see revival in domestic fortunes of some of these pharma companies, Sun stands to benefit. You can obviously pick your quarter, but I think longer term, so for example, if you're looking at financial year 20 and 21 and making the case that domestic pharmaceutical sales are going to pick up after the years of disruption, then Sun stands to benefit on that part. Second, the US base is still significantly large. Taro was operating on superlative margins, and that reset, if the recent numbers which came by is anything to go by, is not yet complete. And that has around a 2-3% impact in terms of downward reversion of FY20 numbers if everything else was to stay same when they report today evening. The third part on which hinges the Sun Pharma investment argument is that Sun Pharma is making significant investments into its specialty initiatives in the US. And that's what's been dragging the near to medium term financials as they kind of ramp this up. It is taking into cash flows from domestic and their old base businesses. So what's important for Sun to succeed in the US market is that their specialty initiatives take off. And when that happens, we see a big revival in Sun Pharma. And I think, from a timing standpoint, FY21 is going to be the year to watch out for when a lot of their specialty assets start picking up. So I think I would leave it at that and not go into the quarter, but the investment argument or the construct around Sun rests on these three broad pillars of domestic doing extremely well, specialty ramping off in FY21, and US generic business stabilizing at some point in time.
Okay. Good afternoon, Mohit. Just want to talk about the industry in general and what's your own analysis of how FY20 could be? Because as per ICRA, the industry would likely grow between 11 to 13%, the Indian pharmaceutical industry. And they've spoken about how new launches, market share gains, consolidation, moderation in pricing for the US market, all of this will aid growth in FY20. Do you feel that this is a good enough summation of what could happen to the pharma industry, or there could be a few disruptions down the line?
So while the broad and headline theme is correct, I think 11 to 13% is a derived number from the fact that nominal GDP growth of around 9%, and then you multiply it by a penetration factor that is giving us a 13% odd number. But within that, how that pie is split is obviously a question still open. We think there are clear disruptive trends, if not on the volume growth side, but at least on the innovation side. In fact, at the sidelines of our conference, we had one of the biggest disruptors, PharmEasy, present and make the case that they see a scope for efficiencies and taking market share from traditional supply chain. That will throw its share of challenges for manufacturers. On the policy front, we see government come out with promoting generic substitution, although it's kind of not mandatory yet, but obviously the government's intent and impulse seems to be in that direction. So that's something which is weighing down on overall value growth of the sector. And lastly, you have initiatives like Jan Aushadhi, etc., which is kind of preventing this 13% growth translate into secular growth of around 15-16% for well-run companies. Now, that being said, I think industry has been tracking well below this number for last 3 years, and even the 10-11% growth that they should have recorded has not come through as a consequence of disruptions on various fronts like GST. And while these technology disruptions and policy interventions will keep some kind of a lid on this 13% number, but I think even a reversion to the old 10-11% on a consistent basis should have a rub off on evaluations and cash flows of these companies, and they would be in a position to invest in the US at the bottom of the cycle, because we have to bear in mind that what we are witnessing in the US, which is an important part of Indian pharmaceuticals profit pool, is an overall deterioration in the market, and the players there seem to be reflecting that as well. So if you look at players like Mylan and Teva, and their challenges seem to be far more intense. So from an industry pecking order, India is an important part of the global supply chain. Okay. They will continue to get cash flows from their domestic operations and be in a position to invest in the US at the trough of the market, which makes for a good investment construct.
Great. Anmol, just one question then, and it's probably the last one on the conversation. But if you were to break it down into pure play pharma, into diagnostics, into hospitals, which segment within this industry as a whole do you feel has the most promise right now? So far, diagnostics seems to be garnering that much more attention. I think it's the epicenter of all the attention at this point. So, how would you play these three different verticals within the industry?
So now obviously, you know, these three all are within the healthcare bucket, but the fact remains that, you know, they have very different capital structures, all three, and different challenges and different opportunities. At this point of time, you know, given the way the industry structure is, I think diagnostics offer as an industry the maximum potential. Now obviously the stocks seem to be reflecting much of that optimism, so you know, I'll not go too much into the price points, but what is quite clear is that as far as the runway for growth is concerned, and a play on shift from unorganized to organized is concerned, we would peg diagnostics higher than hospitals and pharmaceuticals at this point of time. Pharmaceutical also has an export element, which is at the trough, which should revive at some point, but we're not seeing that yet. The return ratios for diagnostics are the highest. Hospitals come second, and at this point of time, you know, because some of the players that we talked about seem to be in the middle of an investment cycle, you could argue that these are trough return ratios, but they are the lowest. So from an industry attractiveness quotient, if I was to put it that way, at this point of time, diagnostics first, hospital second, and pharma third.
All right.
But stock calls, yeah, and valuations are altogether a different matter, because,
yeah, go ahead.
Because, you know, obviously, while what I said is known and is getting reflected in their financial numbers, the market is pricing them accordingly. So,
yeah. Got that. Anmol, it was great talking to you. Thank you very much for joining us this afternoon.